I describe him as a warrior philosopher. And he laughs when I say that. But at the same time, we're very grateful to have him here today, Rondell Benjamin. And there are a lot of accolades, and we'll go through some of them. But good morning, and thank you for your presence.
Good morning, good morning. How are you doing?
I'm all right, thank you. We haven't seen each other for the new year yet, so yes, all the best for this one.
It's going to be a special year. 2017 is what I call Gova season, Rich.
Uh-huh, okay. And so how that make it special? Special in a good way or just an interesting way?
Well, I mean, if you look at the history of the world, where there's conflict and stress, there's growth and evolution. These are, for me, times that are turning points in history. And we've arrived at that time, and I think we're up to the challenge, and moving forward, special things are going to come.
That's like the Chinese word chaos. It also means opportunity.
Or challenge, yeah.
Now, let us know some of the things that you're involved in, please.
Whoa, all right. So I basically am a student of martial arts. But martial arts has three or four categories that are slightly different. There's martial arts, there's martial combatives, and there's martial traditions. And I partake, obviously, and study and just kind of immerse myself in all three of the areas, because really the intent of each of those areas is different. So I'll give you like a quick breakdown. A martial arts would be classically what we call karate, right? A do. It's a way of studying yourself and how you work under stress in a safe environment, focused strictly on developing self, self-awareness, self-actualization, etc. A martial combative is a form that is designed to utilize in terms of physical violence, defending yourself, fighting, aggression, management of conflict, where physical skills are required. And martial traditions were often used in communities to develop soft power, to initiate children, men, women, into rituals that allowed them to fully develop themselves. So in my case, I do Kalinda and Capoeira as martial traditions, which is Trinidad stick fighting. In terms of martial combatives, I do Defense Lab, which is one of the cutting-edge martial combatives in the world, and my martial art is Gracie Jiu-Jitsu. So those are the three things that, you know, I really bury myself into.
That immersion, that burying of self, how did that come about?
I'm not sure, but I think one of the first words I ever said, based on reports from my family, was the first word they ever heard me say was fighting. So I do believe, as they say in stick fighting or calendar, something's in your DNA, it's in your blood. And as a member of the warrior class in this modern world, it has to find ways to express itself, you know. I didn't do the police or the army. Instead, I dedicated myself to the craft of developing my community through martial skills and physical education.
This day and age, do you see many young people in stick fight? And I say stick fight as opposed to just going and looking at the boys, a lime, as opposed to people actually in the tradition.
All right, so stick fighting is really a way of life. And if you come from one of the communities where it's a way of life, it'll be active in your life. So if you go down Maruga, Talparo, Mayaro, and you just drive through the village, you will see children with sticks playing, which is all it is, right? I think it's alive and well. I think that Kalinda or stick fighting is moving into the 21st century. And obviously over the next couple of years, we're going to see it grow and modify itself to match the time that it's in. I think that's the process it's in now. It's in this process of evolving into a form that is useful for now and moving away from its past form, which had degenerated into a kind of rumshop, but kind of drunk men thing. And it had moved itself away from being an initiation ritual to develop community and village. And I think it's evolving towards that again.
How important is that initiation sort of process and having a way of focusing aggression and having that in the community?
So every community or culture that's produced exceptional people have very clear rites of initiation. We have to help our young people transition from childhood into adulthood. And the process, one of the keys to that process, is them being very confident that they could protect themselves, that they could take care of themselves, and that they can grow and learn. Violence and aggression are part of our nature, a fundamental key part of human nature. Unfortunately, we live in a society that moved away from effectively utilizing violence and aggression as a tool of self-awareness, and it became something that we tried to avoid. And once we tried to avoid it, and it became this, you know, what they call like a zombie or a monster under the bed. And right now it's eating the underbelly of our nation. It's just destroying families and communities and cultures because of the nature of it and how we've occulted it from daily life. And I think the key is for us to bring it back into daily life and give these young people avenues and venues and tools to learn to become comfortable with their aggressive nature and to be comfortable with violence. And in so doing, we have the best chance of diminishing its impact on our societies.
In your experience, are there other rites of initiation that are similar in Trinidad and Tobago?
I am a member of the Orisha community in many respects, and I am a stick fighter. I have just recently, you know, been in contact with the whipmasters, and I'm starting to do some jab work. And I notice in most of the combative carnival traditions, there are specific rituals in place to help young people manage how they feel, manage their aggression, and channel it into positive. I think musical communities have the same thing. A lot of religious and communities, as well as cultural-based communities, have all the elements for us to reconnect to these rites of passage. But I would say in the last 20 to 30 years, with the advent of technology and some of the social issues that connected to our coming into independence, these things have diminished the cultural tools and their value. But I think we've come full circle, and as communities now we recognize that we need to reapply ourselves to the traditions that got us here. And so I've seen a resurgence in it. Yeah, but I mean, anything. You could do rites of passage with surfing. I mean, in Latin America, they have the quinceañeros, where, you know, they bring women into womanhood at 15 and have a party. And there's this whole three-month period of training the women to come into it. You know, so it's all alive, you know. We just have to revitalize it and ensure that the communities are driving it and not just individual families.
You've spoken already about harnessing power and how it is we do that. Do you think... And there's also a saying that says any technology that is sufficiently advanced to other people who are not aware of it, it looks like magic. What are some of the disconnects that you see in the communities that you engage in terms of like different aspects of your day-to-day life?
That's a real rich question. It's multifaceted. But what I would say is this. It is critical that we understand that magic is technology that we don't understand. So any technology that we don't have a full understanding of appears to a human being to be magical. And that's anything from an iPhone that's talking to you, to Google, that you just talk to somebody on the phone and all of a sudden Google know that you talk to them and asking if you want to be that person's friend, to having stress in school and going to... be it a christening, a Muslim rite of passage, Qurbani, or some Orisha activity, and feeling this deep connection to self, to the higher power, and having this big shift inside yourself where you start believing in yourself and you take that back into these spaces where you weren't so powerful and confident. And a lot of it is simply, one, understanding how we work as human beings, and two, being in spaces that allow us to explore that. And those two help us develop what we consider to be self-awareness and helps us make better decisions.
Now, we're going to invite some phone calls in a bit, but at the same time, moving from this sort of conversation specifically to safety, violence in Trinidad and Tobago, and bridging to help bridge that, I'm wondering, these communities like Kalinda, Whipmasters, that imbue participants and initiates with skills and talents and techniques, does that also just send them into the world? Because anybody with a hammer, most times the thing looks like a nail.
So we have to understand that the human brain is set up to have what you call cognitive bias. That is predetermined programs that will launch and run themselves, whether we know they're there or not. So if my response to your stress is to teach you to utilize violence only as the response, you will use the hammer and everything will look like a nail. You want to be part of programs and parts of processes that give you options. You know, we like to use in the Gracie Jiu-Jitsu, we like to use 3Ds. First, you have to learn to detect threat, then you have to learn to defuse it. And if you can't do those two things, then you defend yourself. And it's the same in Kalinda, where you have spaces where if a better boy man jump, you go by the drum, you rest on your stick, and you come out the ring. Right? You know, as they say, you know, if your car breaks, to play. And those are spaces and cultures that automatically let you know where you, what you're capable of, what you're not capable of. And it has plenty space to find ways to address it. Because you do know that if it comes to brass tacks and it's kill or be killed, and you're not ready to handle that, then you know what the outcome going to be. And I think that reality check is one of the biggest reality checks that we are not providing for our young people. Because the TV and the social media and the video games actually are facilitating violent psychological development, but that is disconnected from reality. So they're living in this virtual imaginary world. And that quickly comes to an abrupt end the first time you get a stick down in your waist, or the first time that somebody who's as strong as you are stronger shows you that what you imagine the outcome of this will be is not necessarily what will happen. So, the check.
How do Defense Lab and Gracie Jiu-Jitsu help to make that connection with reality and be those positive processes?
Well, fortunately, all these processes are martial in nature, and that there's a systematic, gradual exposure to violent content, and then there's a systematic, gradual exposure to all the tools you need to de-escalate, to avoid, to prevent threat and risk. And Gracie Jiu-Jitsu is a system that's been developed over the last 100 years that's strictly focused on winning by yielding. So they don't meet force with force at all. They try their best to give space, and they utilize that process to try and resolve the problem. Defense Lab is really a scientific, systematic study of violence. So we expose our students completely to what the patterns and the psychology and the physical expression of violence is. And then we give them opportunities, like any lab, to solve it themselves. So they build those muscles slowly and surely.
So apart from the patterns, the neural processes where you're able to say, okay, well, physically this is how I deal with this, are there any social or coping, self-care kinds of activities that happen as well when you expose this person to violence? So even before I'm asking you to treat with it in a physical way, just the fact that someone's seeing something, okay, well, it's possible that someone can do this kind of violence, do it upon another person. Do you all treat with that as well?
Well, the fundamental core of all our programs is the psychology of violence, the psychology of self-defense. How does this impact your organism? How does your past experiences impact how you filter, how you process violence? What are the violent experiences you had, and how did they play out in your life? And then we help people cope with those things. And then from there, we guide them through a process where they slowly, just like a vaccine, inoculate themselves to develop the antibodies or develop the ability to be resilient and to recover from stress and trauma. So our programs obviously are designed fundamentally to address trauma as well. And we do that through 3 or 4 different modalities. But the key always is to help people engage with violence in a safe environment, and give them the tools to work through it and develop skills to be able in the future to utilize it if they have to protect themselves and their family.
So people have more than just a hammer?
You have to have. You have to have a whole toolbox, a cutlass, a file. So, you know, because it's more like, rather than construction, I wanted to use an analogy, it's more like gardening, right? There may be weeds in your yard, things that attack in your plants. So you have to put things in place to address them. But part of that process is learning to care for the plants themselves. And part of the process that we have to take people through is how to care for themselves. And just that self-care is the core of what we do, because self-defense isn't just physical violence. is protecting yourself against any noxious stimulus in your environment. Anything. Smoking, drinking, bad decisions, driving your car without a seatbelt. All those are part of self-defense. So we have to have a holistic program. And that's what I love about the martial traditions that I was able to study. They taught you that from the drumming and the singing and the camaraderie, and you must have food and you must always acknowledge the Most High in everything that you do. So it's a whole process of care, community, personal, interpersonal. And out of this environment, we develop the skills to care for ourselves, even in the most demanding circumstances.
Who are these programs for? And I ask that question because the systems of Defense Lab and Gracie Jiu-Jitsu may be a little more open. This is just from the outside looking in. They may be a little more open for anyone, the average Joe, to assimilate, to be a part of. It seems as though, to me, the Kalinda community might be a little more, not close, necessarily standoffish, but you need to do more to get into the system. And you started off by saying many of these things are community-based, so people would grow up in the thing from young. How do you access them if you're an quote-unquote outsider?
Well, for me, one, there's a big movement in all the communities I've mentioned to open up. We recognize that our nation at this time needs us, because the problem with martial arts and self-defense information is it only works for martial artists and it only works for people who study it. So we've created a lot of opportunities. Not only me, there's several other organizations in the island that have opened up. It's open to everybody. But the key is it's open to everybody who's willing to be part of the process and not who want a short, quick fix. This is not a 3 weeks, come on, I'll go show you 4 kick and 10 push-ups and tell you go your way, you're having. That is the antithesis of what we're about. What we're about and what we fundamentally believe is, like any community, to build skill, it takes time. And you have to invest in that time. And so for me, for example, martial study for a child is not optional. It's just like school. No, I ain't feeling to do that. You're going today. You're going and train and you're going to develop skills. And when you finish the course of study, which generally is 6 to 10 years, then you could progress to something else. So that's one of the things I'd really like to communicate, that as a friend of mine, Sensei Warren Gill, says, martial arts only works for martial artists. So we have to hopefully develop communities of martial artists. And that could be, and that's why we have several arts, so that you can find what best fits you.
In terms of getting in, what is the, is there a stereotype? Okay, this person fits the mold of something that would be positive, that will do well in the system. Is there something like that?
No, you know. One of the unique things about martial arts is there's two unique things. One, Trinidad has one of the highest access to martial arts. You could go in any village, in any town in Trinidad, you're going to find a school somewhere. And you're going to find somebody whose personality matches yours as a teacher. And then you're going to find a class where the class matches your personality. And then the rest is just time, having fun, enjoying it, developing these skills.
If you had to choose, I'm not necessarily asking for your final decision, or if you want to share it, cool. But what are some of the things that you would be thinking about in terms of making that decision?
So the key, obviously, is what you as a person willing to do in terms of how far you're willing to go in order to defend yourself. In my case, I have a motto. It's unconditional survival. Under no circumstance will I give up my survival for the survival of another. That's my personal motto. But somebody may say, listen, I don't want to hurt other people. Then jiu-jitsu is great for you. There's ways to defend yourself that minimize impact to the other. If you're in a situation where professionally you're going to be, the possibility of being attacked by multiple assailants is high, then Defense Lab, which is premised on multiple assailants. There's also things like Krav Maga. There's a couple of tactical systems. There's a couple systems globally that really say, hey, if somebody jump out a bush with a knife and a gun, then this is the information that may help. It may not, it may. If you're somebody who has leanings towards music and culture and loving who you are as a person, as a Caribbean person, then the jab and the Kalinda and the capoeira will better match who you are. I think all martial arts at the end of the day should lead to the same place. And I think they all have benefit. The key is to really just ensure that, to be discerning when you're engaging in your search. Find what is fun for you, because whatever is fun for you is what you'll do the most. And whatever you do the most and the longest will become what you'll do under stress. And so that's the key. Find what you love. And you never know what people love. You shock yourself.
No, we've been speaking about Defense Lab, and many people would have an idea, okay, what is stick fight? Many people would have an idea, what is jujitsu? But in terms of Defense Lab, what are some of the applications? Where are some of the places that we see Defense Lab manifest? So
the Batman movies, Taken movies, a lot of the uber fast, high speed, some of the Bourne movies, Clash of the Titans. It's been very popular in modern popular culture because of how it looks and how unique it is. But it's really like a crossbred between Indonesian Salat and Filipino Kali. Knife fighting, stick fighting, gun fighting, etc.
In this period of time, we're moving from the Christmas into Carnival season. What are some of the things that we should be thinking about with regard to safety, aggression, violence?
So I'm going to step away from the classic line, everybody is trying to panic the public. One, I'm going to tell the public that is the exact opposite. Be comforted in the fact that anybody who is alive has developed a lot of skills that they can utilize right now for their survival, or they wouldn't be alive. They wouldn't make it. Two, trust your intuition. The word intuition comes from a root, which means your inner guard or shield. I suspect that if 95% of our population just deeply connected to their gut and their intuition and followed those feelings they have, we would drastically reduce how exposed we are as a country to violence. And the third thing for me is that fear, there's an acronym for fear, false evidence appearing real. Between the media and between the way in which our communities have evolved, where we're very insular and isolated from each other, we've created this space. We're feeding the monster, and we're falling right into the hands of the criminal element, because fear is how they manage us. And what we have to recognize is that the power lies within us, the civilian citizens, to use our eyes and our ears and our intuition to recognize risk and threat, and as communities face it, because that's really where our power lies. You know, and if you go to certain communities where the community is still very vibrant and alive, where Tanti and then go see a fella walking down the street and call Cousin Mavis and say, hey, you have a strange fella walking down the road. Tell them children come inside. If we connect to that kind of network, this machine that we've developed in the Caribbean for the last 500 years that has kept a people who shouldn't have made it the way we have, with the kind of success we have, alive, then, you know, we feel and to recognize that we have all the elements right now in our grasp to aggressively deal with the way the crime is spiraling out of control. And the key really for me is understanding that the control does not lie with the authorities or the government or anybody, nor does the responsibility for protecting ourselves. It lies with us. And once we take that approach, that, all right, nobody gonna help me, we gotta help each other and we gotta help ourselves. And you recognize that you have all the tools you need, even without doing a single martial arts class, right? And as a species, we've survived for so long under so much threat that we've evolved these mechanisms deep down and outside ourselves to survive. Just plug back into that, and a lot of things are going to change really quick.
You think we've, as communities, kind of shirked our responsibility and given up our power to say, okay, hold that, you take care of me?
Yes, and I think it's partially due to the politics of how we became independent and how it changed us as a nation, and how the politicians have used and encouraged us to give them our power. And it shows itself up on many levels, in many spaces. You know, when you look at the statistics, I think it's 2 out of 3 women in Trinidad at some point will be assaulted sexually. But it won't be from some random stranger. 89% of the cases are somebody you know intimately and closely. And if a family recognizes that a young man is perpetrating violence against women, they need to speak to other families. And then we need to isolate these people and push them out of our communities. But that's not what's happening. Because we're keeping secrets and we're hushing and we're not talking. We are feeding these young men who are making bad decisions. And then their courage in terms of taking higher and higher levels of risk will be fed. And then you take somebody who had a series of bad actions, and it could turn out that person could end up becoming a serial killer, partially because the community is not putting a stop to it early enough. So that's just one aspect of it. But I mean, we're a society that if we allow violence that occur against our women and children, we are feeding a monster. Because every person who's ever been captured and caught as a serial killer has one thing in common. They've been abused or violated when they were a child. So each child that we allow, or each young woman that we allow to be assaulted, we are now planting these seeds in future generations to continually spreading this disease of violence and out of control.
Going back into our history, what's the significance of the Jammet and the Boaman?
Well, the Jammet comes from a word which is like perimeter, or the people of the surrounding areas, the people on the outskirts. And in our culture, the Maroon culture, the people who resisted colonial oppression were always placed on the outskirts. So Jammet culture is the culture of resistance, of defending the village, of protecting the family, of, you know, I grew up in places where mother this and auntie that and tanti this, them women and them wasn't playing. And they would put a stop to and put the brakes on anybody who getting out of control in the yard or the barrack yard or the village or the area. And one of the key tools that these women had were the strong men in the village, you know, the stick men. You couldn't go to the police in the colonial days, but you could go to a man who the whole village respected. Unfortunately, the colonial authorities recognized that there was this power developing in these communities that was out of their control. And a lot was done to destabilize and to make illegal and to make criminalized the behavior of these men who would control the villages. And what we've done is, by criminalizing it, we've taken so much power out of the communities that now a community leader is tantamount to saying a criminal. But we need community leaders who aren't criminalized and who can utilize their skill and knowledge and strength in the community to enforce and protect the communities. And so it's a real delicate kind of tightrope walk we have, where the very structures that were set up that got us where we are the structures now that are being used against us.
And what are some of the things that we use? And in terms of cultural practices and saying, okay, this is what we used to do, and we're going to consciously draw on it in order to go forward.
One of the first things was the in Central Africa, there was something called a Mbongi. In the Caribbean, it was called a convoi. And for example, Raoul Gebern and Sunita Maraj are trying to revitalize the concept of the convoi, which is a meeting of the voices of the village. We don't have effective ways of getting communities together and having them voice their issues and then giving them the resources to act out for themselves what they need to do. And that's all how a lot of slave revolts and post-colonial activities were managed. That's how the trade union grew in the Caribbean, because we had a culture where we would meet, we would talk, we would come up with our plan, and then we would go and do something about it. You look at Agape, you know, you look at Gayap, you look at Susu. These are all mechanisms where communities would get together and build themselves. And so I think that having spaces where we could get the young people together that are fun, that allow them to express themselves, even parts of themselves that we don't want to deal with, which is the aggression and the violence, giving them spaces to express fully who they are, while seeing elders express themselves fully, so they have a model to follow, is the key.
But how do we get back to that? You said that it seems as though there's a shift back to that. But at the same time, there is so much of disconnect where people, sometimes it seems as though the digital self is a little more real than the physical one, because somebody will talk to you, black is white, on Facebook or Snapchat or something else, but they're not necessarily, they mightn't tell you two words when they see you in person.
I believe at this point that we have to take a step back and ask ourselves, listen, what generation is best focused on? There's a famous author called W.D. Du Bois, I believe, and he spoke about something called the talented tenth. And we're in a desperate situation where we have to seek out our talented tenth. We have to train them. We have to prepare them from now to make the changes we want in the future. I have in many respects not given up, but said, you know what, the generation I am in and the generation after me are past a certain point. And we must now focus on the kids. We must focus on them as young as possible, get them into programs where they are forced to face themselves and face others, get them into programs where they have to address their aggression, their sexuality, all these things now that we pretend they're not going through, get them into spaces where they have to move and breathe and talk and feel consequence, and I think good things will happen.
How do people get onto you in terms of, like, they want to get their children into one of these programs or systems?
We're on Facebook, you know, Gracie Jiu-Jitsu Trinidad and Tobago, Defense Lab Trinidad and Tobago, Bois Academy Trinidad and Tobago, because, you know, that Trinity the Bone. You could call us, 498-2609. We are on the web, DL-TT. Just look us up. Come see us. We're in Barataria. We have schools in St. James, schools in El Dorado, you know. Come see us, schools in Shogunas. And, you know, our objective is to create these safe spaces where our people, our nationals, have a chance to develop the toolbox we're talking about so that violence and fear do control them.
Rondell Benjamin, thank you very much for your time here this morning, man.